两杯了，有孩子事。
All my flower.
Oh, here too.
Khana ya ui kha phat thai mi I kha phat thai ho lu kha ko to has been or ho lu full time ho ko wa ta teacher a ta just kan ta je lu ja sam ma je ko chi ho lu na je ya ko la nyau je se je ya ko chi wa kha me na pa ko je ko to has been lang se je chi to te ปีต้นเดียวเท่าไอ้คอยเหรอไอ้คอฟันไอ้อึวันนั้นเจฟันดอกอึเท่าฮะก็ฮะป้าต้นนึงมินจีต้องรู้เชื่อสมมติเ
กิดเอเซสไซเไอ้เชจะปวดตัวจ่อไอ้จัดจ่อเนี่ยนั่นละไปหัวเตี้ยเวียนหนังวัดนั่นนะเจ้าทำได้ยาเยอะวันนั้นแอฟเคนเนดียาตัวประธานรู้เชื่อได้แต่แล้วตัวมึงวัดจ่อเนี่ยตัวนั่นละก็เตะเตะเตี้ยมาเขาทำมายาวันนี้นะกำมือสมากูจีกูชิสายถ้าชิมาแล้วตัวตอนนี้เราก็เตะเจแล้วสักกับเป้ป้าเลยเจเลยเป้จะท่านะมาถอยยอดที่ชิมเรามาแล้วหัวเตียแล้วตีมันเบี้ยยอดแต่ยา CIA น่าอยากเจเลยตัวมันเป้ว่าท่า CIA เจเลยมั่วเป้เจาะหลุดเป้ว่าสิแล้วตัวตั้งรู้เลยได้ยอดตัวเตะชิมเราเจกับเป้หาสารรู้เลยได้แต่เจเขาที่อ้อเจก็เป้ป้าเขยเลยจะนั่นเป็นป้องตัวไทยนี่ละก็เต้ป้องอย่างเขาที่เป้เจอกันเป้ป้าเจียสักแก่โฮจิมินเนี่ยตัวไทยนี่ละเต้ตัวมึงตัวนี่ละก็เต้เนี่ยนะก็เป้ป้าไทยสักแก่แต่เจ้าถอดเป้ต่อเป้ต่อหัวหรือนะวัวเจ้าเป้วัวเจ้าลีละหายเจ้านี่ละมึงชิตอนนะก็เต้เจ้านี่ละเดี๋ยวจะจะได้จะไทยเป้เนี่ยจริงนี่ละที่เราจะฆ่าตัวเป้เจ้าตอนนี้เจ้าเป้เราเลยวัวจ้าเป็นอะไรออกใจเจ้าท่อนี่นะท่อเป็นชุดเด็กเจ้าแล้วหัดที่อเมริกาเจ้าเป็นท่าอเมริกานะเจ้าแล้วเป็นแล้วตัวเจ้าแล้วก็ต่อยาวยาวแล้วในพม่าป่าเจ้าการนี้เจ้าหนึ่งตัวมุ่งเด็กชาวอเมริกานะเจ้า
So this is the one that my assistant gave me that her sister had done.This is the creation story, and you'll find a lot of these. But the unusual thing is the dragons in the middle. This type of stitching really is relatively new in the Hmong culture. It really didn't get started until into the, when people were in the camps.
After Belato, Thailand, okay? Belato, refugee.Thailand ที่เดียวเป็นยอดรู้แคมว่าแล้วหัวนั่นนะนะโอเคถ้าไปเป็นสัตว์ที่เป็นสัตว์เนี่ยจะเป็นชิมัวอาจ
ี lots of things to show
yeah เป็นสัตว์เนี่ยจะจะอ๋อเด็กใช่ไหม
จะน้อยนิดเดียว
เป็นสัตว์เนี่ยจะโอเค this กูเที่ยวไปลงมือดีไซน์ตัวนี้ได้เป็นเท่า
จะน้อยจะอ้วนท้องรู้สึกเหงื่อเต็มจังเล
ย yeahกูดีไซน์เต้าอีได้ปันเต้าเจถมเต้ากูมั่วๆเจตกโปรผาบ้านโปรผาบ้านมันเต้าหายเหรอนะยอดไทยเจน่ะ I believe it.
And one of my assistants, his wife made this one. This is just a small one. There are much bigger ones that tell the story of fleeing, but but because it's from her, you know, it's special.
I bought a couple pandao that showed the journey across the Mekong, and I purchased one for the library. Janet Swiston was a teacher's aide who became a teacher again in the program, and it seemed like it was a fairy tale. I don't think that a lot of people really, really understood what it was like to be in that trauma, being hunted, have family members die right in front of you, to be taken from your homeland. We hear stories of that happening in world wars past, but we didn't know anybody that that particularly happened to. So I think it was part of our narrative, but not something that many of us could connect to. So, and I don't think we had an opportunity to hear that firsthand. We did through the textiles, but not through Hmong voices.
This one
is his uncle. Itu mika hu ya.
Kuchpo le tajim la mon timbe wo thampak na.
She's not that old, but they are. He's probably like 18. So no, I mean 15, 16, and he has a younger sister. So mom's probably not that old, except that he doesn't know the mom's age. And they was hiding, and they between. It took them a whole month to come to Thailand from Laos to Thailand. It's not that far, but you have to like hide during the day and walk during the night. And then they was hungry and sick, and pretty much like hungry. So his mom,
no food.
Yeah. His same thing for us. We could just like cut down a banana tree, and you just eat the inside, or whatever plant that you think that you know that it's not you can eat, and it's not a present. We have to eat it, and then his mom. They were so hungry, and she passed away.
Yeah.
And then
on the way.
Yeah, on the way over here, and like a couple nights after the mom died, like they tried to take her as much as they can. So
they take turns to carry her on the back until she passed away on his first cousin's back, and they bury her like they just like we came we had to like a flower, like a hole or whatever you call. Yeah. So and then if you have to dig for something to eat too, because you need to have knife and a hole, and then you can cut down something to eat or dig something to eat. And then after the mom passed away, they just like make a hole and put her in, on the ground. And then 2 days later, his brother was just can't walk anymore. So the brother was still single. Between that, this one's pretty sick too. Like they were sangry and they was on the jungle for so long. And if you are hiding in there, that's like you don't have that much strength. So they both are getting sick, and then there's no food. So they just the group that came with them just like everybody had to come. So none of this one would stay with the brother, but he cannot move anymore. And he told them to leave him behind, and he said, go and tell my uncle to come and get me. The uncle is this one. Because the uncle came to...
For me, I was drafted when I came to this country. I didn't know anything about America, didn't know anything about Vietnam, but all of a sudden, I'm in this war. I spent 6 years in the military. So whenever I see a Hmong veteran comes in, I'm embracing him, because probably it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be here today. But a lot of people don't think that way. How the Hmong guy applying for benefits, he's getting it, I'm not getting it. Well, don't you remember what he did for us? And some of the younger Hmong students, I say to them, hey man, there's knowledge here. Embrace it. Don't be doing the American French fries and apple pie.
เจแล้วที่ตุ๊ดตาญาละกะเตตะกะเจเปญญาชิตาโฮเตเจมรอนเจเปยอตอหลอเตเจตอเปหลอนนะเจเปตอตะรีอะไรนะบริฟิจีตอเตเจนะ
I was born in Laos and spent about, what, 3 years in Ban Binai camp?
No, we don't live in Ban Binai. We live in Nam Myong.
Nam Myong. So we spent, what, 3 years there?
Yeah, 3 or 4,
and then
almost 4.
I was 4?
4 years, yeah, 4 years.
Just when turned 4 here. When we came here.
We got to Minnesota, lots of snow.
Lots of snow, it was cold.
Yeah.
I remember looking around and seeing...
The tree, no leaves.
Yeah.
It was so strange, but I don't know why. I'm not scared.
And I remember just really noticing from the view of a four-year-old that people looked differently. I mean, I was aware enough to notice that, so... It was cold, people looked differently. I definitely knew we were in a different place.
So. The gentleman, I was talking to him, he was probably about 80 years old. And I was just talking to him, and he began to cry. So I said to the interpreter, is there something that I said that offended him? And the interpreter said to him, he said, I feel like a blind man in America. And to me, I said to him, what exactly does that mean? Because I'm looking at him, he doesn't look blind. And he responded, I could see you, I could hear you, but I don't know how to respond. And it was just one of those that made me sort of sick to my stomach, because I thought, this guy's hearing me, he's seeing me, but he's still blind to the culture. And after he left there, I had this sort of embracement, a sort of more attachment, because when I came to this country, I felt like a blind man in America. I didn't know the slang, I didn't know the language, the food was different, the streets were different.
I moved to Stevens Point in 1985. And then one Sunday morning, Jim Vang showed up at church. Jim, in his gentle way, said, you know, my Hmong people are kind of hidden in their homes because they are afraid of the community. And I didn't tell them at the same time that the community was afraid of them moving in, this Polish... you know, strong Polish community with really in the, probably the most white Caucasian congressional district in the United States.
There was a degree of prejudice coming in. You know, mm-hmm. this was the whitest district in the nation.
I know that it was at the time, it was the whitest congressional district in the...
At one time, we were the whitest congressional district in the United States.
Before the Hmong got here, this is a pretty white community. And very, very Catholic, very Polish. And my in-laws even said when they moved to this community in the 1930s, the only thing that saved them was that they were Catholic, because they were not Polish.
There was one of the old... a fine Polish farmer who was at the meeting, and it was through the county board, and some of the town people were there, and he looked at one of the Hmong people and says, how come you have so many children? And the Hmong man looked at him and said, because none of them died. And there was silence in the room. And so I said, tell me about your family. He was from a family of 11 Polish people out in Polonia who basically had a large family because they had a farm to keep up and they needed the people to work.
Well, we have, I think, 3-4 guy American farm. They are planting the cucumber for pickles. And my people go to rent it with them, and they grow it, they plant it, and we just go weed it and pick up when they, you know, and sell to the owner. That's why the sticking point is growing Hmong population very fast, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And bring people from La Crosse, from Minnesota. I think they started 1986.
This is used to be one of the field behind where the corn is. That used to be a pickle field. I didn't really pick in there because I don't like to.
It's hard work.
It's hard work. Because yeah.
It was backbreaking. And
yep, we get up at 4 in the morning and be over there by
4 if you're lucky. You know, some people have to get up earlier to cook and clean, and you know, like my mom, you know. So the older ones would have to get up and cook some food and, you know, prepare it ahead before you get to the pickle farm.
Even we're only like elementary schools.
Yep.
The Hmong population in Point had started to grow a bit. There were a few more families coming who moved to Point. And if you know about the importance of secondary migration with the Hmong community, you'll know that as soon as one family moves, there's a tendency to have, you know, more families following, because we're a clan-based system. And so, you know, if one member of a clan comes to a city and they like it, then chances are 4 or 5 families are going to follow. And so I think that was one of the times where a whole bunch of families moved to Point. And so as a teenager, for the first time, I started to see more, you know, youth that were Hmong.
I don't have a lot of memories.
All I know is that was, you know, the first.
I'm younger, so I don't
remember. I was young then, too. I was naive, didn't know anything. I was just thinking, you know, okay, we're moving to a new place, yay.
You know, having the Hmong come here was quite a shock to this community.
I actually had people come up to me and say, well, why don't they go back where they came from and so on? And it's like, oh, and these were neighbors to a family. And when you think that the kids had to live with that kind of an attitude of neighbors, how they managed to keep positive and everything.
In the early 90s, there was a lot of racial profiling. One time, some Caucasian was tailgating us and hit us, and we went to the police station, and just because we were Asian, we were arrested.
Your stories were never heard.
Yeah, our stories were never heard. And I would talk to other youth or friends, and it was the same stories too. So
we had an incident where the students, they must have been juniors, and they were living in village apartments. And there was some harassment. There were a bunch of other residents started throwing snowballs at one of the Hmong students that lived there, and talking, you know, making very racist comments. And he got really angry, and he got into a fight with them, and they beat him up pretty bad. As far as I know, you know, the people that did that never had any charges brought against
him. Yeah, you don't know your face, and I say, you don't know your test. And
I got involved with the Hmong population. I was working at a community action agency and I was doing public relations. And we got a call one day from Pastor Knudsen, and he was calling together kind of the do-gooders of the community because he had had some of the Hmong people that had approached him about some of the problems that they were having at the technical school. And so there were probably, I'm going to guess, 15 to 20 of us that met over at Trinity Lutheran Church. And for the most of us, it was the first time we had ever heard of the Hmong. I remember asking my supervisor, should I go to this meeting? He said, yeah, you better go find out, you know, who the Hmong are and what the deal is, because we knew nothing about the Hmong people. And I, when I say we, I mean as a community, we didn't.
At the first time we arrived in Portage County, people didn't know who we were, and some people even asked us, were you from Vietnam or were you from China? And I happened to tell people on the street saying that I was from Laos, and we thought that was a good idea to provide community education to the community here in Portage County.
We just kind of started with really nothing, just by listening to what the needs were that the Hmong presented to us and finding ways to solve them. And so I was looking for ways to do a Hmong education day, and knew that, you know, if we had a day just about the Hmong for the public, that maybe the right people wouldn't come to hear that. It might be the people who already were interested and were working with them. So we came up with the idea of, let's just have a big gathering on the riverbank and everybody bring something of their ethnic background, and we'll just all share that. Well, that developed into the Portage County Cultural Festival.
That time, the Hmong came to settle here, and I think there was a difficulty in assimilating and or being accepted here.
When you bring people together, they just naturally learn from one another. And I think that's what's happening.
But the first year that we were there, you could watch the crowds, that they would walk along and look at different people's exhibits and buy different people's food. And then when they got to the Hmong table, a whole lot of them would just kind of go out and skip it and then come back in and look at the other ones. And you could actually see that happening. Well, now at the festival, the Hmong food is some of the most popular food that we have at the festival. And people come, you know, with coolers to buy egg rolls to take home and that type of thing.
This is how we make Hmong egg rolls.
We can use a chicken wing. We take the bones and the meat. Oh, I think the bones only.
You just dig bone.
Take the bones out, and then put the ingredients inside.
How long have Hmong people been eating egg rolls? Ever since I've
been
in the United States, indeed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It doesn't exist in Laos, or?
I don't know. I just know in this country. I don't know in Thailand or Laos.
Ready.
I used to work for McKinley, and I just want to thank Mrs. Abby. She's my boss, and I like working with her. She's very nice.
So we had some Hispanic children, and then we had Hmong children, we had a Cambodian child, we had a Vietnamese child, and so put it all together, and we had 12 students in 1986. So we started an ESL program.
We came in 86, and there were already families here. Okay. Johnny Zhang was already here. His family was one of the first families, his in-laws, the Lee family, And Lee Vang, you probably know Lee, and Mr. Vang is the tailor here in town. Okay, anyway, that family was one of the early families. So there were a number of families already here, and enough to start a program.
Once we arrived in this country, why I say it's scary is you can't speak English. I remember going to school, I would cry, and I can't tell my teacher I miss my mom and my dad, that's why I cry. And because I would always be with my mom and dad, and there when you arrived here, you kind of get split from your parents and you go to school.
I think education was always pushed. It was like, we want you to get as much education as you can. It's good for you, it's good for your family, you know, it'll be good for your clan, it's good for Hmong people, so it's, you know, it's really a great thing.
It came to a point where, you know, I want to be like the rest of my friends, and so I started studying really hard, and then it just hits me that this is what I want for my future. Someday I want to go to college.
I was the first one to graduate from UWSP, one of the first Hmong students, me and Zaya, we graduated the same year.
I didn't know too many people, and especially, you know, Hmong women that I could relate to. It was a hard adjustment for a while. I think Sue Clark kind of helped us organize. I think as we had more Hmong students, we realized that we need an organization that would pull us together. So I think that's how it came about.
I really learned a lot from those first students. They were all very traditional. They're what I've heard termed is the one and a half generation, where they weren't born in the United States, but they came here as children or youth. And so they're not first generation and they're not really second generation. They're kind of right in the middle. And they had a lot of issues with, you know, this transitioning.
I think I had, like people my age, I think we kind of have to balance between two worlds. Like being at home, I have my mother and my father-in-law and my parents. And I had to speak Hmong, and then at work in school, I had to speak only English, and then so it's different between these two worlds, and then you have to balance, kind of like a bike. If you fall off balance, then you're kind of in trouble. So
I think my mom and my parents always believe in education, so I think that made my transition from home to college easier. But I know at time, I think some community people may have viewed me as an old maid, you know, but, you know, I guess I didn't think much about, I had my goal that I want to achieve, and so it didn't bother me.
And it started as more Hmong residents moved to this area. They really didn't have an organization to help them out to integrate into the community. And so the organization was formed to kind of give them a voice. Our goal now is just to keep promoting our culture so that the community knows about us, and to teach the younger generations about some of our cultural through our Hmong New Year. We host it every year in September. They're usually the second weekend in September at Lake Pakwa. It's been an event that we've had going on for about the last 22 years, I believe. Our event is a two-day event, and it includes a lot of traditional folk song singing, a lot of papas where they ball toss between a boy and a girl, and it's more like a courtship thing that they do. And then we also have a soccer tournament that goes on just to draw people in, volleyball, and then we also have vendors selling crafts, clothes, movies, CDs, and food vendors as well.
We're celebrating the New Year. You may want to cut this part out. Coming together as a community to celebrate our culture, and for I think the younger generation to also kind of remember the traditions and the different aspects of Hmong culture.
I came yesterday because I was invited to speak, and I'm just working on building relationships with the Hmong community. We came back today because I had such a good time yesterday, I wanted to enjoy it a little bit more today.
she had talked about it yesterday, and I had no idea that there was this big of an event that kind of piqued my interest, and I wanted to see everything that was going on.
But I just like to keep it simple, so first day I always wear it traditional, the second day I'll wear it in like different color, whatever, so that's how I do mine, so
yeah. Then you just chop wool, you take that, then you start to cut the chain on the side. แต่ว่าจะต้องนั่งเท่านั้นจะเป็นอยู่ว่านั่งในเท่าอะไรเช่นนั้นนะโดยเป็นอยู่คนรอนะเจ้าเก๋ว่าปรีว่านั่งเท่านั้นเจ้าเป็นเฉินเฉินชายเจ้าเป็นว่าเราไม่เมื่อเช้าคอยเจ้าเก๋ใจรอรู้เจ้าตักอันนั่นเจ้านั่งจ้องรู้จ้องรู้เจ้าหมดจะตู้เจ้าเฉินเจ้าเจ้าว่าอินอยู่เจ้าเลยจ้าล่ะ แล้วเขาเป่าลูกเจแล้วเขาเป่าปักเกยเลยเจไปที่ว่ารอรู้ตัวเสียเหรออย่าด่าอุ้งดันได้เจไปว่าเราไปยังชายเจอเที่ยวเดี๋ยวเราไปยังไปยังว่าเจอหรือยังไปยังจะว่าทุกอย่างไปจะชิโตมันจะชิโนเจียกิจใจมองเจไปยังจะเหยียดเหยียดจ่อชงเชียวไปยังมองปลีอยากอยู่เจนปลีหน่อยปลีเท่าไปมองตุสกาเท่า
So I'm having a baby due in April, and part of our culture then is before the mother gives birth, you do this, it's called oneng, but oneng ceremony. So basically what it does is it just protects the mother and the child so that when you go into birth, everything is goes smoothly.
Yeah.
那么非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天了,非常多天
mà yo tu tho tu chi nei to yo cho bi cho sư loa tia vi da bi bo vi tu tu vi tu ki yo na ma pi cho mu nyo to sa la to te pe chi mon nai mo pe chi mon nai khu ye yo tho tu nia na yo sa bi yo cho bi no ai tho wa tu nia na yo tu mi nyo la ma te yo da yo hu On nama Nikuchi Patun Chu to Duatia. To an nama, more nungi the ku, my jungling touch a little cone on aya. Molly ye, not to a tokulu, on nana. Jaybo was saying that she more ye, not to honour. Be on nangwa yanama to mona Yanina Pekuchi Pot. Had a jungly jack, that she ma. Cú anh nên một số tụ đá hồ mà nửa hạt tiệt, bên núng có cái rong này nhở, giờ đây bên núng thì có cụ rong có cụ à nó nhở, sơn nó mỏ hộp đi, vậy giờ nó nè cháu à tụ nè thế thử hạt tiệt bên khoan sơn mông nó, nếu cụ rong được bên thế, giờ nó mà cụ thế này hạt tiệt, cụ tụ uo nó mà nè cháu hạt tiệt nè nó thử cụ hạt tiệt, ô giờ lô mà giờ uo mà bên tụ mỏ mà nửa hạt tiệt bộ nó núng giờ bộ nó núng chủ rong sơn nào nhở.
The shamans were important. The healers and solvers of problems I think in many ways that was another form of health care for the Hmong people.
So what I will do is an open-ended questions. And I will say to them, what did the spiritual leader say to you before you came here? Well, he says to me that I may have worms. Really? And you know what happens? If you check them for worms, even though they're not related, these guys are intestinal parasites. So how could I not embrace that particular knowledge, even though I don't know the training that the spiritual leader goes through?
Tonde pepi na je pe ojo mo pe chene je kolelo no na je tona tona to tonde po je pe de pe wo pe chene nga mona na patao na je ne te tao na je ne po jo ji jong ni tonde pe ojo mo ji tsa ne ro pe na je ne de ya thì nó mà bây một quần đã là tàu đó xem mà bây tàu quần đội trong này trú chạy cầu nó chạy nửa mốt cái kia giống gì nó bút được bây chạy tàu nó chạy bây theo liền tới chạy thì nó thấy lột sạch rồi nên không nào còn nó hiểu ít khó và chuyển trang theo và lấy bỏ tàu bây lấy ba tàu bây chạy nam mốt mà hải sản tập xa mà cho mốt kia tua còn nó lấy cũng biết được bút tàu trâu giống gì bút được bây cho đến hôm sáng xin nó tan thôi cho vô giống gì chạy cho cho mấy chạy nhau đi học bây nó chạy cũng này cũng giống gì hàng
We run the Plover Shuta Funeral Home here in Plover, Wisconsin. We serve the Hmong communities in Portage and Wood County and other counties, but since Wood and Portage County, this is the only funeral home that actually services the Hmong community. What normally happens is there is a 2 to 3 week delay on most funerals where they use that time to contact people, and people arrange to come to Plover for the funeral. And people have come from Thailand, they've come from Florida, New York, California, all over the place. And that's one thing about the Hmong culture that I wish we would take something of is how they honor their elderly. We seem to dismiss our elderly as they get older, whereas there's more reverence. The older the person is in the Hmong community, the more revered they are. Before this, I didn't realize what a large Hmong community we had. You know, you run into them in the community. It's really nice to be able to chat with them there, and they recognize who I am, and I think they respect what I do for them, and it's just nice to find out what they do in the community, you know, whether it's at the YMCA or at the store or whatever. So that's the nice thing about it, you know.
Like what I learn in like class and stuff, like when we talk among people, we talk about Vietnam War or shaman, like shamanism and stuff, and like, you know, there are like Hmong Christians out there too. I grew up a Christian, so like just coming here, I was like, because then I do have cousins who are like shamans and stuff, but I would never associate myself because I'm like, oh, like, you know, I don't want to go because I'm too scared. Like when we do like funerals, like they bang the drum, and that was always so scary to me. Like I was like, I can't go. Like, so like when we do have to go like funerals and stuff, I refuse to go because I get so scared. And like, I think like just coming here and just learning about it, like, because then I do have a lot of like, you know, like shaman like friends and stuff, like, you know, where they do practice like shamanism, and like just me like, you know, learning like Christianity, like, you know, the gospel all my life, and just like, oh man, like, okay, now I see, like, you know, I understand it more. So like I was able to like learn more about Hmong culture.
When, like I said, like the culture and the religion is so intertwined that when you have a relative that is still practicing shamanism, and they call you and invite you to their event, which, you know, which contains Hmong culture, but it also contains shaman rituals as well. And when you say, no, I can't because I don't practice that anymore, then they, because you're not denying the culture part, but you're denying the religion part. And mm-hmm. And when you deny it, they, it's like one thing, like I said. And when you deny the religion part, they take it as the whole thing. And so when you say that I can't attend it, then they take it as, oh, that person doesn't want, they're not Hmong anymore. They don't value the Hmong culture anymore.
There are like churches, like Hmong churches around, like, mm-hmm. you know, throughout like U.S. too and stuff, or like just in Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. And we do have one in Stevens Point.
Yeah. I go to Trinity Lutheran Church, and the previous pastor, Ken Knudsen, was very involved with helping Hmong folks. Jim Vang, who you know, came to our church, and for a while we had several Hmong families that came in our congregation. And then we opened up our church for, like, when the Hmong elders would have meetings and so on. And they had a keng classes, which that's still on my bucket list. I want to learn how to play a keng. Mm-hmm. so he was very involved in those of us in the congregation were involved also.
The Hmong Alliance Church purchased the Evangelical Free Church. Jim always wanted, you know, had a great connection with Trinity, but he felt he, you know, the Hmong Alliance Church needed some leadership, and they couldn't afford a full-time pastor at the time, and so he really provided the leadership and Bible study and in their worship.
And they kind of made it seem like Christian are good people, not Christian are bad people. I guess I just want to say that I don't believe in that. I know a lot of non-Christians, and they're very pleasant people too. So, because I know a lot of Christians too that are, or people who claim they're Christians, and they're really bad people too. So, I guess it's just how you practice your religion and how you are as a person.
Kids today, they are not interested in working in the garden. Unless we really ask them to help to weed, then they help, but only for a short time. the person who is working so hard in garden is the mother. And I don't work a lot in the garden either. I only help the mother a little bit.
Yeah, we get lectured. We don't get grounded. And we get like forced to go garden.
It was recognized that in the Hmong culture, many people were farmers, and back home that's what they did. So I think they were looking for ways to help them acclimate to our state, or, you know, our nation. And that was one of the things that their people, the Hmong people, really desired, was a place to be able to garden.
This is where the gardens were. We had about 200 plots that went from about a few hundred feet over to the barn and farm area to the east.
I remember why we ran across to one another and how we
got to be friends before this because right. You used to come out with your children
and ride in
the tractor.
I remember that because CAPSOS has a program that is a family matching program. You remember that?
And we were going to do it, and we started doing it through the church.
And you were matching through the church, so, and right. You matched to one of the Hmong family, and my family matched to one of the Caucasian family too, so that's why you get to know the Hmong people and become Hmong friends. And I remember that I came over to your place, and I even got to fish in your little pond in the backyard, got some fish, took home too, so that's how we got the garden.
The garden came to about where this road is, because there was a ditch going through here, which they buried now. And this was all fields all the way to the back. The barn stood about in this area, and the house was where this bank is here.
You know, I think a thing has been changed. You know, when we were farming, everyone was still young. Everything changed. People changed. The area changed.
The gardening itself was kind of like a seasonal family gathering, especially when you see the same people come back year after year. It was a lifestyle that we shared with, even though it was another culture, it was a lifestyle that we were able to share with them. And they had the same, they were working towards the same thing that we were, only we were on a different scale. We sold the farm in 98, that was the last year I had the garden there, I think. And this is already 13, so I guess that's 15 years.
For that big one, the Portage County, you know, this is my name, is a San Hu Tuan, the Sting Point. Who are green little chisel now? A big mong, my being near Jow, a Dian Dow, a big Jabaku, Jadow, Jadia, Jabutza, Jalu, a Jadow, Jaroku, Jazilu Sua, Jakaya.
This is nice. It gives me something to do for retirement, and I'm happy to rent to the Hmongs, and they're good to me and I'm good to them, and that's the way we go, you know. So this is different, you know, than the big farms around here.
Like I said, at least 35 family here.
Yeah,
so he's a very nice person to us. So,
well, I never want to look down on anybody. Yeah. You know, we're all in this world serve God and do the best we can. Mm-hmm.
Now it seems like it's the big thing for the Hmong community to do the veggies and flowers and go to the markets. So I think it gives them more of a sense of control of Lukao was saying that it wasn't like working for someone else picking cucumbers where you had to be there, otherwise you lose out. You can do it more at your leisure, like we cut back because of family situations, but we can still keep doing it.
When Hmong first moved to Portage County, they were dependent on public assistance for their life. And I encourage people to go to the employment, to go to the workforce, the work field. And people did not speak English. People were scared to go to work. So we provide education to these people. Do not be scared. Do not be afraid. Just find a job.
You know, we had a number of employers that really stepped forward, and I have to credit the Hmong people, because you would get somebody employed and they would do a good job, and they were hard workers. And so the fears were put to rest then. And so, you know, it was often just the challenge of getting the first person into a place.
If one person is employed at this company and that person says, hey, this is a great company, they treat us well, they, you know, workers, we have plenty of work here, you know, come join me, you know, and that's where all the Hmong people swarm to, you know. So just like Woodward Governor, I'm sure when his dad started working there, there were maybe one or two, three other Hmong employees there, and then all of a sudden, you know, it blossomed, and now, you know, if you go, and now Woodward Governor is now point position, and if you go there, you know, I'm pretty sure they can say at least 25, if not more, percent of their workforce is Hmong.
In the mid-1990s, I ran Golden County Foods, and the economy was booming at the time. And people were job jumping for 25 cents an hour. So we had a large turnover. And at that time, we decided we really need to figure out a way to stabilize our workforce. It just seemed like a perfect fit, really. Here's a culture that needs some help, and here's our company that's growing fast. It's one of the things I'm proudest of, really, in my career, was to be able to take two cultures like that and be able to blend them together as one, and form a good, stable workforce out of it. Anytime anybody comes here, and if this, and we realize that for a lot of people, this is going to be a stepping stone job, and that's just where we're at, and we know that people are going to want more out of their life, and when they move on, it's great, good for you. Mm-hmm. Fellow left here today, he's got a new job starting the week. Congratulations, I'm happy for it. I say, hey, thanks for giving me the opportunity, but no, it's very fulfilling to see people move on and better themselves, and if we're the stepping stone, great. Mm-hmm. That's wonderful.
We realized when we were teaching downtown at the library and we're losing students that we knew there were a lot of people who still need help and could benefit with help from English.
We know our workforce has some, language barriers that they would like to learn. You know, they've expressed that, hey, sometimes when supervisors talk to us, we don't quite understand what they're saying. We'd like to know more.
And we just decided the easiest thing would be to go to where the students are, and we've done that with Spanish speakers on some of the farms, and we thought that if we could go to the workplace and offer services where people are as a group, it would mean they wouldn't have to get down to the library, they wouldn't have to find babysitters, and that maybe we could help them be more effective in the workplace if we actually came here. The reason we started classes with the Literacy Council, ESL classes, was because there was a special grant for Hmong who had just recently come because they closed down a Thai camp.
The last group that really came to this community and to the country was in 2004, 2005, 2006. The closing of the last refugee camp meant those families needed to have a new home.
I started right before the first wave of, or the last wave of the refugees came over. So it was, 2003, 2004, in that time frame. Yeah.
At about the age of 4, I came to the United States. So I actually went through Bon Vinay refugee camp. Of course, I was very young at the time, didn't know much of my surroundings. And then the interesting parts was I would ask my students that I got to tell me stories or, you know, the landscape of where they were, what they did, you know, was there a river, there were, you know, ponds, mountains, streams, caves, or anything that they often explored. And we actually got a kick out of that. At lunch, we would talk about, you know, what did they do for fun there? So the kids really enjoyed sharing their thoughts and their experiences there with me.
I think everybody came here and they just felt like they had to change so fast because I didn't really see a difference. They just looked like everybody else. I think that if you spoke to them, then you would know, oh, they're from the last wave of the refugees. Then you knew, but other than that, they just blended right in. When you go into their house, same like everybody else's. I mean, they knew how to take care of the house. They did everything just like a normal, you know, westernized family over here. I think that it's amazing how, like, just within 10 years, I mean, it's crazy how they have full-time jobs now, they speak English, you know, some even got their GEDs, diplomas, some are in college, they even bought their own houses and cars, and I would never expect that, you know, and just thinking, wow, you've only been here for, less than 10 years, and you already reached these mini milestones.
A lot of the students, or Hmong, I would refer to them as Hmong American students, the ones who grew up here in America, they actually were very uncomfortable with the new refugee wave. They didn't know how to interact with them. They didn't really know how to talk to them. And so it's because of that cultural shift too. I mean, you have like something completely different. You know, even though it's the same culture or same concept, it's still surrounded by a different environment.
At first, they're like, they're speaking English to you and then you don't understand them, which you feel like, come on, we're all Hmong, you guys should be talking Hmong with me, stuff. And then, as like, you hang out with them more and more, you understand that like, they can't really, really communicate all the way. They can only say some word and they can't say it. Some word.
Actually, I can. So,
but then they do understand you too, so.
It's just that you grow up learning English, so a lot of Hmong youth don't really know Hmong anymore. That's why they talk Hmonglish. like you talk Hmong and then you like add some English, like how I did. But it's like you're so modernized now, so you like don't really follow the tradition and everything.
Our parents' lives are different from ours because they came from Laos, and now they have to change their religion a little bit and like change the way that they do things, because here then they have to follow expectations and laws as if they were in Laos. They could like, they had different laws and stuff, so they had to change a lot.
You know, it's not the same as it was in the 1990s. You know, it's not the same as it was in the 1970s. And we have rules and policies and expectations that are the same as when it was back then. It's not going to fit who we are. You know, and I think as a Hmong community, we need to come together and understand that my Hmong American identity is very different from my mom's. Even though we're sitting together in the same space and time, we've shared many experiences, it's not going to be the same. And it doesn't make me any less Hmong than my mother.
Yeah, sure.